Good morning, everybody. You're very welcome to our service this morning. I'm just going to start by reading from Romans chapter 5, verses 7 and 8. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let's pray. We come this morning as a gathered people to worship you, Lord Jesus. You are an amazing God. We thank you that you're a God that is above all power, and that you should love us so much that you would send your only Son to take the punishment that we deserve. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that you came and that you laid your life down for us, Lord. Help us this morning to give you the worship that you deserve. Help us to focus our eyes on you and to come this morning with open hearts, eager and willing to accept what you have to say to us. We ask for your Holy Spirit's anointing on Seamus and use him this morning to speak to us. And we ask everything that happens here will bring glory to your name. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to start by singing Mission Praise 560.
Everyone. Good to see you all. Warm welcome to our service here this morning. A couple of announcements. Tomorrow night, as usual, the bowling in the hall. And then there is nothing till Wednesday night. Wednesday night is our prayer meeting, our Bible study in the Mackay rooms. That's at 8 p.m. Thursday morning fellowship is on this week, so this month's speaker is from the RANLI, and that's the Royal National Lifeboat Institution, and that promises to be a very interesting talk, I'm sure, so all welcome to that. Starts at 10 with a cup of tea, and then 10:30 the program will start. 9:30 on Friday morning is our Little Islanders in the Hamilton Hall for our mothers and toddlers. That's really all our announcements. Can I bring us to a short portion of God's word that I want to speak on a little bit later on. But also I want the boys and girls to be listening to this because there's a message in here that I'm going to bring out at our children's talk. So the Apostle Paul is speaking is really some of his final words to the Corinthian church. And this will be the last Sunday in that series, so we'll finish up the series today. This is what he says, verse 14. Now I am ready to visit you for the third time, and I will not be a burden to you, because what I want is not your possessions, but you. After all, children should not have to save up for their parents, but parents for their children. So I will very gladly spend for you everything I have and expend myself as well. If I love you more, will you love me less? And we'll just end our reading there. So, boys and girls, can I see you down the front? Morning, everyone. Good to see you all. All in good form? Yep, come on, Ruby. Good to see you. All right, so I have a series of slides for our children's address this morning, so I want to see if you can find out what they have in common. So here's the first one, and can I say, boys, just because this is my thunder, don't show the last slide until I tell you the last slide in this here, we see is, because I don't want you all to get my thunder, if you know what I mean. So this is what they have in common. So here's a little boy and a girl giving each other a hug. That's the first thing. Here's the next slide. There's a boy sharing a lollipop with his friend. So that's another slide. What about the next one? Two boys playing football. Next slide. Somebody giving a present. Can you think what have they got in common? Hold on, there's more. Next one. Just a group of friends with each other. Next one. Oh, somebody has fallen and they've hurt themselves. Little boy is helping the girl up. So he's giving her comfort. Then they're helping with their mum or dad clean windows. And next one. That's the last one I want to show. So just being kind. So they all have something in common. What do you think it is? You had your hand up a while ago. Are you not so sure now? I think you had your hand up first, Harley. They're all being nice to each other. That's one way to put it. That's very good. Sam?
Generosity
is another word. Can you think of any other words? It's not the word I'm looking for, but love, yeah. They're all showing acts of love and kindness. And so they're sharing and hugging and helping and being friends. And those are all ways that we can love people. Can you think of any more? Any other ways that we can love people? What do you think, Charlotte? If you were to be nice to your friends, how would you do it? You would play with them, that's right. And especially with a little boy or girl who didn't have anybody to play with, if you played with them, that would be very loving. Anyone else? Can't think? Well, we've pretty much covered it all. Those are ways in which we show love to other people. And we do that. We show love to other people. This week was Helen's birthday, so I went out and bought her a bunch of flowers, and I bought her a card, and got her some of those wee cakes from the milestone. Didn't buy her a whole big cake because she wouldn't want that. I just bought her, you know, the wee buns. They're a bit cheaper as well. And that was, I showed love to my wife, and then the kids came up on Friday night and they cooked her a meal, and it was wonderful. Someone asked me on the way out from Brookfield, well, did you buy her a present? I didn't buy her a present, but anyway, so we show people that we love them by giving to them. And the Bible verse that I read just before I asked you to come up was the Apostle Paul saying how much he loved his church. He said he loved them so much he would gladly spend everything he had for them and spend himself as well. In other words, he would just do whatever it took to be loving towards his church. And we should do that in our church. We should love one another in little ways, in acts of kindness towards one another, to show how someone is special, or to treat them specially. But here's my thunder. There is the greatest expression of love that someone can have for someone else is not just to spend lots of money on them or anything like that, but is actually to die for them. Imagine if someone loved you so much that they were willing to die to protect you. They gave up their life to protect you. That's what our next Bible verse says. Greater love has no one than this, and to lay down one's life, that means to die for one's friends. And the cross beside that shows us that that is what Jesus did for us. So Jesus loved us so much that he was prepared to die for us. And indeed, he did die for us. Someone once asked a person, how much does Jesus love you? And he stretched out his hands, this much. And that was the pose that Jesus had on the cross. He was crucified for us. So boys and girls, we should love one another, but never forget that you are so loved by God that he died for you. God's love for us is the best kind of love. It just means there's nothing he wouldn't do for you. There's just nothing he wouldn't do for you. He loves you so much he would do anything for you. And we're going to sing that now. We're going to sing God's Love is the Best Love. It's to the tune of the Flintstones. We all know that tune? Yeah, we think we do. You'll pick it up. You'll pick it up. So God's love is the best love.
Deeper and the deepest sea, greater than.
Ronnie Wilson was in hospital up until recently. I haven't heard if he's out yet, but I want to, as a congregation, to bring Ronnie before the Lord in prayer. And also for Dorothy, who had received her operation just last week, just pray for her sustained recovery. And I think we need to, as a congregation and a community, to pray for Detective Chief Inspector Caldwell. We need to bring that man and his family before the Lord and pray for his recovery as well. So let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we thank you that you are a good God and that you do love us and that your love is the best love that we could ever, ever know. And so we are confident then that when we come to you and pray in faith, that you will hear our prayer, O God, and that you will answer according to your wisdom, according to your all-seeing and all-knowing knowledge. Father, we think of Ronnie, Lord, and we pray for him and pray that you would grant the doctors wisdom to be able to treat him, and that soon he would be returned to his family. Just bless them, Lord, and help Edna and Hannah not to worry unduly, Lord. Undertake for him. And for Dorothy as well, we pray that that operation would have been a success and the bones would knit and her recovery, Lord, would be sure. Just bless her, Lord, and undertake for her. And we pray for for Detective Chief Inspector Caldwell, and pray for him, Lord, and pray for his recovery. Lord, it's our hearts have sank as we have heard the news of the way he was gunned down. And so, Lord, we just pray, O God, and pray that it would not be a catalyst for an escalation in the troubles in our community. And so bless him, Lord, and raise him up to full health and strength, we ask. We pray for his family as well. Pray that you'd surround them with love and courage and encouragement and assurance that the community around them, the country around them, indeed many of the world, are praying for them. And Lord, as we sit here, we recognize that we are different people in different places in life. Some of us are going good, and some of us are going through our ups and downs. And so, Lord, whatever is going on in our lives, you know. And so we pray for ourselves in these prayers of intercession and pray that you would strengthen, that you would grow, that you would bless, that you would help, that you would draw near, all because you love us. We pray and ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing our hymn of the month. We're going well on it, Unto the Almighty. It's a lovely, lovely hymn. Thank you. Lovely. Good singing. When I or someone in my position stands here in their pulpit on Sunday morning and opens God's word and shares what's on their heart, I suppose the reality is that we are speaking to different people who are in different places in life. Some are open to that message, some perhaps are close to the message. Some are going through an horrendous time altogether in life. There's stuff going on, and other people are just on top of the world. Everything is fine. And the minister, looking down on his congregation, he might know some of what's happening in the lives of his flock, but he'll probably not know everything that's going on. But God knows. God knows what's happening, and the Word of God, by the Spirit of God, is able to, by the, to take that message that's given and apply it to different hearts, so that it's the Word of God to those people in those situations. And that's because the Word of God is alive. It's active, as Hebrews says, as sharper than any double-edged sword. It's able to pierce right through to the heart, dividing, judging the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Someone once said, we don't so much know the Word as the Word knows us. And as Paul wrote his letter to the people of Corinth, the reality was that he was writing to different people who were in different places in life. Some of those people, primarily needed comfort and encouragement. Some needed just guidance, a little bit of guidance and direction. Some needed perhaps teaching and training. Some needed correction and challenge. And some within that church needed to hear a warning, perhaps for some even a final warning. I think in this last sermon of this series, most of these are present in this final chapter and a half. So I'm going to close our series, our time in 2 Corinthians this morning, suggesting that Paul is sharing his final thoughts to perhaps three different groups of people who are gathered. It's not as clean as that. There will be overlap, I'm sure, but... And there's overlap in our lives, there's no doubt about that, but it's the primary thrust of God's word to that person at that particular time. I pray this morning that as I share this last sermon in this series, that the primary thrust of his powerful word will come to each of us wherever we're at, and regardless of what we're going through. So here's the first category of people, if you like. Those who needed to hear a message of God's love and assurance. Let me read you the section. Now I am ready to visit you for the third time, and I will not be a burden to you, because what I want is not your possessions, but you. After all, he says, children should not have to save up for their parents, but parents for their children. So I will very gladly spend for you everything I have and expend myself as well. If I love you more, will you love me less? Yet be that as it may, I have not been a burden to you. Yet, crafty fellow that I am, I caught you by trickery. Did I exploit you through any of the men that I sent you? I urged Titus to go to you, and I sent our brother with him. Titus did not exploit you, did he? Did we not walk in the same footsteps by the same Spirit? Have you been thinking all along that we have been defending ourselves to you? We have been speaking in the sight of God as those in Christ. And everything we do, dear friends, is for your strengthening. So Paul is promising to visit this church. Promise that he's made before, but up to now been unable to keep. But now he's ready to go. At his last visit, he had harsh words to say. There was confrontation, there was tears, and he desperately doesn't want it to be this way this time. There are people in this church that Paul just wants to get alongside and to reaffirm his love to them, to assure them that all along he has had their best interests at heart. This is a spiritual father coming to his children in the Lord, if you like. And I guess we understand that, certainly those of us who are parents, we get that bond. And indeed, the strain on that bond where there is or has been a misunderstanding between child and parent. So Paul wants to strengthen that. He wants to affirm his love. He wants to reassure them that he does care. I've been saving up for you, he says. I don't expect you to save for me. I would gladly spend everything I have for you and myself as well. I didn't exploit you. Everything we do, dear friends, is for your strengthening. As a loving father, he loves them. As a loving father cares for his children, so this man cares for those he led to faith. And in expressing this, Paul is expressing the very heart of Christ for his church. This is how the Almighty God of heaven and earth feels about his church. He loves them. He wants the best for us. You see, Paul's message to the Corinthians is actually Christ's message to us. He is speaking, he says in that passage, in the sight of God as those in Christ. So it's not merely human sentiment he's expressing, it's divine expression. This is how God feels about us. Psalm 103 in the Old Testament says, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. So perhaps Paul's message to that church could find resonance with some here in this church. Some perhaps who feel that God doesn't love them, that he's not for them. Well, he does love you, and he is for you. No matter if the bond of relationship has or is being strained somewhat. Perhaps the takeaway thought for you, if you find yourself in that position, doubting God's love, is just the message or the reminder of his unending love and assurance. Can you open up your heart to that he does care, that he is for you? Perhaps it's best encapsulated in that little children's chorus. We could have sang it, but I wanted to sing the Flintstones, but we could have sang it, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. God loves you. That might be the takeaway thought as from Paul's last chapter in this book. Or perhaps the takeaway thought for you from this closing sermon is to hear a message of God's concern and loving correction to you. That too is here in this passage. Maybe it was to some whose repentance was partial, not fully complete. Because here's what Paul said next. He says, for I'm afraid that when I come, I may not find you as I want you to be, and you may not find me as you want me to be. I fear that there may be discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, slander, gossip, arrogance, and disorder. I am afraid that when I come again, my God will humble me before you, and I will be grieved over many who have sinned earlier and have not repented of the impurity, sexual sin, and debauchery in which they've indulged. He's expressing what he's afraid of, a grave concern that some in his church remained mired in sin. And so the matters that he addressed in 1 Corinthians, the first letter he wrote, the division, the disorder, the carnal desire, he was afraid it would still be there. Nothing had changed when he paid them his third visit. And if that were the case, he'd be grieved, he'd be upset, he would be humbled. My words, my efforts have been wasted. And if that were the case, he would bring correction. If I don't find you as I want you to be, you're not going to find me as you want me to be. So there'd be more strong words, rebuke for some correction. There'd be tears. Sin would be exposed, and he would have difficult one-on-one conversations with some. Sin would be dealt with. Paul would not be afraid to deal with it, to call it out and to deal with it. And that concern for him in that church, just like God's love and assurance for the weak, it goes beyond human sentiment. It's how God feels about us in this church. Paul's concern at a lack of repentance among the Corinthians reveals the very heart of Christ for his church where there is remaining sin. This is how the Almighty God of heaven and earth feels about you and I when we, for example, fight with one another, or when our hearts harbor things like jealousy and arrogance, where we're driven by selfish ambition, when our words are not gracious but filled instead with gossip and slander, where we wallow in sexual lust. Like Paul, God, when he sees those things in our lives, he grieves. And it is possible to grieve the Spirit of God. It's possible to upset him. Paul told the Ephesians 4, chapter 4, verse 30, says, "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you are sealed for the day of redemption." So our sin has that potential to grieve the very heart of God. Pre-flood, in the book of Genesis, we read that when God saw all the wickedness that there was upon the earth, that his heart was deeply troubled. And our sin does trouble the one who died to take it away. Folks, it's possible for us too, like the Corinthians, to still attend our church, to be regular here, and sit all the way through a series like this, hear God's heart for us. But if we're not putting our sin life away and growing in holiness, then it's really all in vain, isn't it? We hear, but we don't hear, and we see, but we don't see. It made me think, about what makes for a successful church. Is it the inspiring praise and worship that we hear? Is it good preaching? Is it growth in numbers? People are coming out. We tend to say, don't we, our church is going well if people are coming out and if people are taking part. That wee church is going well. But those metrics might not necessarily mean it is a successful church. Here's God's metric for a successful church. It's holiness. It always is holiness. It always will be holiness. We see Jesus standing in the midst of the churches in the book of Revelation, and he's not commending them for their use of technology. Nor is he saying, the harmony of your singing was beautiful today, or even for the numbers that are attending the church. No, he's commending them instead, or correcting them in some cases on matters like perseverance of the faith, keeping going when things are difficult. That's worthy of commendation. Or for having a pure heart, or being free from idolatry. That's what matters to God. That's really what matters to God. Those other things are great and they're important and we love them. But where God finds sin, then it grieves him. And it's the Holy Spirit's work in our life as individuals and as a church to root it out and to work in holiness. Because God's word is clear. It says we are to put to death whatever belongs to our earthly nature. And he lists those things. You see them on your screen. Those are the things we must put to death and get rid of. And for some in that Corinthian church, Paul was afraid that he'd come and he'd find that they hadn't done that yet. He'd visit them and he'd see things just still as they were. And so his message to some in that church, not to all, perhaps that message finds resonance with this church. Folks, he calls us to be in a continual state of repentance. And perhaps the takeaway thought as I preach this final sermon to different people who may well be in different places is a reminder that our sin grieves the one who died to take it away. Can we open our heart to that? Can we receive that? Can we believe it and turn away from those things that offend the holiness of God? That's what he's doing, I think, in this final chapter and a half. He is speaking to different groups of people, different people. Some weak saints who needed comfort and encouragement. Some unrepentant souls who needed challenge and correction. And there was too, as I read the chapter, I think a third group of people that he addressed. The false teachers who had come in among them. They needed to hear a final warning. And let me bring us to that part of the text, chapter 13, verses 1 to 6. He says, "This will be my third visit to you. Every matter must be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. I already gave you a warning when I was with you the second time. I now repeat it while absent. On my return, I will not spare those who sinned earlier or any of the others, since you're demanding proof that Christ is speaking through me. He is not weak in dealing with you, but is powerful among you. For to be sure, he was crucified in weakness, yet he lives by God's power. Likewise, we are weak in him, yet by God's power we will live with him in our dealing with you. Examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not realize Christ Jesus is in you? Unless, of course, you fail the test. And I trust that you will discover we have not failed the test." So the tone here changes. It's legal. It's judicial. It's witnesses and prior warnings and a final ruling. And when I come, I will not spare you. And Christ is powerful when dealing with you. I believe he's talking directly to the false teachers, to those who had turned the Corinthian heads, and also perhaps to those whose heads resolutely refused to turn back to the true gospel. This is tough talk from God's servant. And beloved, there is a place in church life for tough talk and radical action. Tammy, what do you do with an apple in a basket that has gone completely rotten? You take it out. What do you do with cancer in the body that threatens to kill the body? You remove it. You surgically remove it. To save a life, you have to operate and take it away. And I don't say this because I need to say this now, but I say this so that if we ever did need to do this, then it's been said. What's to be done with church members who live in serious sin, blatant public sin, and who refuse to repent? Well, to preserve the honour of God and the witness of the congregation to the community around us, because that's what's at stake. It's the role of the elders to exercise church discipline. And if it happens to be the minister who's in serious sin, or any of the elders who are in serious sin, then it's the role of the presbytery of the church or the judicial commission to do that. And I hope we never need that here, but it does happen in churches. But I want to make the point, as the text, I believe, allows me to make it, so that if it ever does come to this congregation, then that you can see it's here, it's in God's word, and that you'll understand that there'll be a process of discipline to go through, and you'll not take sides. And you'll not allow the necessary work of church discipline to become a reason for discord and division. You see, God has delegated his authority to do this very necessary task to the elders of the church. It's their role. It's what they're called to do. The God who spoke encouragement and comfort to the weak, concern and correction to the unrepentant, through Paul also exercises church discipline through him. He says, we are weak in him, yet by God's power we will live with him in our dealing with you. It's why eldership is such an important role. It's why it's a calling. It's not a promotion to a higher rank within the church. Please don't think of it like that. And it's why in our upcoming election of elders, we should vote wisely, looking for godly character in those we will nominate to that role. And we should look for compassion too in people like that, because that too is in this text, because even though it had come to that very severe, drastic action that Paul was about to take, he is not at all triumphant about it. He would rather be seen as weak and wrong if it meant seeing that there was a true change of heart. Let me read you the last passage. He says, now we pray to God that you will not do anything wrong, not so that people will see we have stood the test, but so that you will do what is right, even though we may seem to have failed. For we cannot do anything against the truth, but only for the truth. We are glad whenever we are weak, but you are strong, and our prayer is that you may be fully restored. This is why I write these things when I am absent, that when I come, I may not have to be as harsh in my use of authority, the authority the Lord gave me for building you up, not tearing you down. So his closing thoughts in this wonderful, warm and heartfelt letter that he has written to this church, it contained final encouragements. It contained final concerns and corrections. It contained a final warning. And I think lastly, it contains final commands to everybody. What he said next applied to everybody that he was writing to. And it's another change of tone. From judicial, he becomes much warmer once again. He says, finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. strive for full restoration. He's appealing to this church. Encourage one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All God's people here send their greetings. And you know, I noticed in his final words, there's not a hint of vindictiveness. No hint of bitterness. Nothing but love and compassion for this people. He'd been hurt, badly hurt by all this. There's just a sincere hope that his words will find a home and his words will work in turning this church around. And indeed, I hope, brothers and sisters, that his letter will have left a similar impact on us too, that we as a church will go our way rejoicing and striving for full restoration and intent on encouraging one another and living at peace with one another, and that the God of peace will dwell with us. There's just one more verse. I'm not going to preach on it, but this is it. Here's how he closes this letter. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. It's how we close every service of worship, isn't it? It's the benediction that we know and love. It's what he conveys and invokes upon this congregation. We'll say those words when we take our leave from one another in a little while. But I'll pray first, and we'll sing our hymn, and then we will say the benediction to each other. Let me pray. Father, we thank you that you know us, and you know where we are in life, and you know what we're going through, and you see us, Lord, you see our hearts, and your bottom line for us is love. You love us enough to comfort and encourage us. You love us enough to challenge and correct us. And you even love us enough to issue a final warning. Lord, may we heed your words as we have read them and looked at them over these past months in Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. And may we be the better for it, a wiser and holier people, and a people that strive together for the hope of the gospel in this community. We pray and ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. We're going to sing the doxology. It's a benediction. It's a short piece. We'll sing it through twice. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Say these last words in this book of 2 Corinthians, perhaps we could all say it together to each other, say it out loud. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.